is communion. Your body broken, the cup we're drinking is bittersweet. The gift of friendship, truest salvation, born of your suffering on Calvary.
Angel said to the women, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? Let us pray. Lord, we gather in your name to celebrate that glorious moment when life had victory over death, and our Lord was able to conquer the grave by your power and your might, demonstrating, O Lord, your sovereignty, your majesty, your awesomeness, O Lord. And we gather, O Lord, to acknowledge your power, your mercy, and your grace, that through Jesus Christ, who lives, we too shall live. Lord, let your Holy Spirit be with us. Through Jesus Christ, O Lord, we pray. Amen."
The first scripture reading is taken from the book of Mark, chapter 14, verses 1 to 15. It was now 2 days before the festival of Passover and unleavened bread. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were looking for a way to arrest Jesus secretly and put him to death. "We must not do it during the festival," they said, "or the people might riot." Jesus was in Bethany at the house of Simon, a man who had suffered from a dreaded skin disease. While Jesus was eating, a woman came in with an alabaster jar full of a very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on Jesus' head. Some of the people there became angry and said to one another, "What was the use of wasting the perfume? It could have been sold for more than 300 silver coins and the money given to the poor." And they criticized her harshly. But Jesus said, "Leave her alone. Why are you bothering her? She has done a fine and beautiful thing for me. You will always have poor people with you, and anytime you want to, you can help them. But you will not always have me." She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body to prepare it ahead of time for burial. Now, I assure you that wherever the gospel is preached all over the world, what she has done will be told in memory of her." Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 disciples, went off to the chief priests in order to betray Jesus to them. They were pleased to hear what he had to say and promised to give him money. So Judas started looking for a good chance to hand Jesus over to them. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, the day the lambs for the Passover meal were killed, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and get the Passover meal ready for you?" Then Jesus sent two of them with these instructions: "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house he enters, and say to the owner of the house, The teacher says, "Where is the room where my disciples and I will eat the Passover meal?" Then he will show you a large upstairs room, fixed up and furnished, where you will get everything ready for us. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God for his holy word. Amen.
Our scripture reading is taken from the Gospel according to Mark chapter 14, verses 16 to 26. The disciples left, went to the city, and found everything just as Jesus had told them. And they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, Jesus came with 12 disciples. While they were at the table eating, Jesus said, "I tell you that one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." The disciples were upset and began to ask him, one after the other, "Surely you don't mean me, do you?" Jesus answered, "It will be one of you 12, one who dips his bread in the dish with me. The Son of Man will die as the scripture says he will. But how terrible for that man who will betray the Son of Man. It would have been better for that man if he had never been born." While they were eating, Jesus took a piece of bread, gave a prayer of thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. "Take it," he said, "this is my body." Then he took a cup, gave thanks to God, and handed it to them. And they all drank from it. Jesus said, "This is my blood, which poured out for many, my blood which seals God's covenant. I tell you, I will never drink this wine until the day I drink the new wine of the kingdom of God." Then they sang a hymn and went out to Mount Olives. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God for his holy word. Amen.
Would rocks cry out to worship? Whose glory taught the stars to shine? Perhaps creation longs to have the words to sing, but this joy is mine. With a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more. Who else would die for our redemption? Whose resurrection is our rise? There isn't time enough to sing of all you've done, but I have eternity to try. With a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more. Praise to the Lord. King of heaven, praise for he rose, now he reigns. We will sing forever, praise to the Lord, to the Lamb, to the King.
This scripture reading is taken from Matthew 28, verses 1 to 10, from the Good News Version. After the Sabbath, as Sunday morning was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. Suddenly, there was a violent earthquake. An angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled the stone away, and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid that they trembled and became like dead men. The angel spoke to the woman. "You must not be afraid," he said. "I know you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has been raised, just as he said. Come and see the place where he was lying. Go quickly now and tell his disciples. He has been raised from death. And now he is going to Galilee ahead of you. There you will see him. Remember what I have told you." So they left the tomb in a hurry, afraid and yet still filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them and said, "Peace be with you." They came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. "Do not be afraid," Jesus said to them. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God for his most holy and precious word. Amen.
I invite you all to listen as we read from John chapter 20, verses 24 to 29. And it says, "One of the 12 disciples, Thomas, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, 'We have seen the Lord.' Thomas said to them, 'Unless I see the scars of the nails in his hands, and put my finger on those scars, and my hand in his side, I will not believe.' A week later, the disciples were together again indoors, and Thomas was with them. The doors were locked, but Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and look at my hands. Then reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop your doubting and believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Do you believe because you see me? How happy are those who believe without seeing me?" This is the word of God. Thanks be to God for his most holy and precious word. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, as we come before you this morning, we want to confess our sins and also to give thanks for all that you have done in our lives. Holy God, righteous and merciful, cleanse our minds and free our conscience from the things that have divided us from you. We have shut our eyes to your glory, our minds to your truth, and our hearts to your spirit, and yet we want to love you. Lord, to offer you true worship and joyful service, pardon and deliver us from all our sins. And since all our paths are loving and sure, guide us in the way we should go, and lead us to life everlasting. We confess our sins to you silently. God of kindness and grace, we, your children, thank you for sending your Son Jesus to save our lives from sin. Lord, as we focus our attention to you during the Lenten season and what it signifies, we have so many things to be grateful for. We thank you for the joy we have in our homes and school, for the comradeship of our fellow classmates and teachers here at Hillview College, for the delight we have in nature that surrounds us every day, the refreshment we find in good company as we are back out to school and can interact with our teachers and friends. We thank you for the knowledge that we have gained in our respective subject areas and ask that you be with us in our exams, for the patience and courage you have given us and continue to give us through this time of COVID-19 and our upcoming exams. We thank you for the peace talks that are ongoing between Russia and Ukraine. Lord, we ask for your protection on all those people affected and a resolution soon. We thank you for those in the past who fought for human rights and for the continuing service of those who have a vision and a world made fair and lovely. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for in our lives. We ask that you bless our students as they go to write their exams. We ask these mercies in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Who is he? Creation trembles at him. eyes that burn like fire. Who is he? Oh, the wonder he inspires. Who is he? Who are the guilt and shame for those who've gone astray? His name is Jesus, Jesus, from the Father's own right hand. Jesus, Son of God and Son of Man. Jesus, who died and rose again. Jesus, he's the Lion and he's Jesus, from the Father's own right hand. Jesus, Son of God and Son of Man. Jesus, who
let us come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Thy word, O Lord, is a lamp unto our feet, and a light unto our pathway. Speak to us, O Lord, in power and in might. Speak to us in a still yet clear voice, that we may understand, O Lord, that we may grow in wisdom and grace, that we may grow in faith and confidence, knowing, O Lord, that we are committed to the one who bought us with a price. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength, our Savior, and our Redeemer. Amen. If we could point to one event that was the foundation of our faith in Jesus Christ, what would it be? We heard from our scripture reading about his betrayal at the Last Supper. And we heard about his crucifixion. While these are important events in the life of our Lord, the event that would stand out undoubtedly as the foundation of our faith is the truth of the resurrection, which we celebrate at Easter. There was doubt about the resurrection from the very beginning by even one of his disciples, Thomas. But the evidence of the empty tomb for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, as recorded in the New Testament, is indisputable. But what significance does the resurrection have for us today? The first thing is that the resurrection of Jesus Christ, in that we see the clear demonstration of the power of the true God. Ephesians 1 verses 19 to 21 tells us that it is the power of our Heavenly Father that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. The resurrection could not be done through human device or effort, but only through the supernatural power of an Almighty God. The second thing the resurrection means for us today is that it proves that Jesus Christ is God. That is exactly what God the Father wanted to communicate to us. As we read from Romans 1 and verses 3 to 4, Paul says, he was given the gospel according to his Son, who was descended from David, according to the flesh, and designated Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection. Jesus Christ our Lord. The Jews crucified Jesus Christ because to them he was blaspheming when he said that he was the Son of God, equal to the Father. The resurrection of Jesus Christ demonstrates the truth of that statement, that he was who he said he was. The third truth for us is that our salvation depends on our faith in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In Romans 10 and verse 9, we are told how to be saved. It says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. This means that we cannot be a Christian unless you believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The fourth important point for us about the resurrection is that the resurrection of Jesus Christ demonstrates to us that all the teachings of Jesus Christ while he walked upon this earth were true. Everything Jesus taught was true, including his great promise in John 6 and verse 40, when he said, everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Jesus' teachings concerning his person, his work, heaven, and the future judgment are all true. Next, the resurrection of Jesus Christ secured our justification. My friends, Christ died for us so that we can be saved from our sins, and he was raised for our justification. Paul says in Romans 4 and verse 25, this means that it is through Jesus' resurrection that we are made right with God. Furthermore, our own resurrection depends completely on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 14 tells us, we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 14 also testifies to this truth when it says, knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you unto his presence. Again, the resurrection of Jesus Christ demonstrates that this Jesus Christ is going to be appointed judge of all the people of the world. In Acts chapter 17 and verse 31, Paul told the Athenians, for he, referring to God, has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. We see the name of Jesus being the name by which we too will be raised. We too will be judged. We see the same idea in John 5 and verse 22, where Jesus himself said, moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son. The question is, my dear friends, how do we respond to the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Because a response is required. We are told in the Bible, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Paul told the Philippian jailer in Acts chapter 16 and verse 31, believe and you will be saved. The Lord Jesus is the Son of God who became human. He was crucified, he died and was buried, and he was raised from the dead on the third day according to the scriptures. The same Lord Jesus Christ ascended into the heavens, is ruling and reigning even now and will come again to judge the living and the dead. This Easter, my dear friends, may God give us the faith to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and particularly in the fact that God raised him from the dead. May we come to know that Jesus Christ is our Savior. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
As Term 2 2022 draws to a close, we have much to celebrate and be grateful for. It has certainly been a journey. We have partially transitioned into face-to-face classes with a sense of hope, positivity, and joy. As we move together forward, students and teachers, you continue to demonstrate patience, diligence, motivation, and determination since the return to classes. I applaud you all for staying the course amidst the challenges that we continue to face presently. I am certain that all of you have been excited to return to meet and greet your friends and to socially interact as best as possible, given the COVID-19 protocols. I know that you are taking your time to readjust to school life physically, the classroom environment, and life here on the Hill. Remember, we are all in this journey together, and we know that one day soon, school will officially return to normal classes. The Ministry of Education has indicated that all students are expected to return to school in Term 3. If there are any changes, the school will officially inform everyone. Let us continue to help each other daily with a kind word or deed, showing courtesy to each other. Encourage each other and smile, even though we are still hidden behind a mask. To the teaching staff, I praise you all for being the incredible group of professionals that you are. You make a positive difference every day in the lives of your students. You connect to your students with passion, flexibility, and grace, and most of all, constancy to purpose. Your unfailing commitment shows me how deeply invested you are in teaching and nurturing them. You continue to build them up to deserve a great education. I thank you and laud you for the invaluable contribution that you are making in their lives. The main responsibility we have is to fulfill Hillview's mission and vision to provide a safe, caring, happy, creative, and challenging learning environment where you, the children, are empowered to recognize and achieve your fullest potential, thus enabling you to make a significant positive contribution to humanity and the environment. This term we received fantastic news with the scholastic achievement of our students. We continue to shine in the East as we copped 7 scholarships, 1 open and 6 additional nationally. We are very proud of our students' successes and wish them the best in their future endeavors. As we bid farewell to Term 2, let us all take this time to reflect, rejuvenate, and renew ourselves. Ponder and do some soul searching, trusting in Almighty God who has stood with us faithfully during this pandemic. I encourage all of you to set aside time for open air activities. Go to the beach, exercise, hike. Enjoy the fresh air which nourishes and restores balance and healing. Easter has returned yet again. In conclusion, I leave this uplifting quote with you from the book of Joshua, chapter 1, verse 9. Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest. Have a happy and holy Easter. School reopens on Tuesday, April 19th, 2022.
Let us bow in prayer. As we go, O Lord, help us to be more mindful that Jesus Christ is still alive and his promises have all been sure and true. And his promise that he will come again to take us to himself will also be sure and true. Help us, O Lord, to honor his name and to acknowledge that he is not dead, but still alive. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with us and all of God's people wherever they may be, both now and even forevermore. Amen.